stop that screen, it's now on there. Okay. Is that what you want?
Yeah,
to
yeah, yeah.
Try a different one.
Good morning. Welcome to St. Mag's Church. As people continue to come in, the band are going to lead us in a song called Faithful One. We'll do a proper welcome in a moment. Welcome if you're watching online already. I'll come back and have a little bit more of a chat in a second. But as we gather together, we're going to sing. The group are going to sing Faithful One. Enjoy it. Allow this to help focus your minds and to be present in this building this morning. My friends, welcome to St. Mag's this morning. How are you doing? It's really hard to see behind the masks. Everyone's just like that, and I can't tell whether you're smiling or scowling or whatever. But welcome. My name's Sam. I'm the vicar here. Welcome if you're a visitor, or welcome if this is your first time in a while. Welcome to those who are watching online. Trina is our online host this morning, looking very gangster. She's like with big headphones and a mask and everything. Do you just want to come and wave at people who are going to be there? So here she is. Can we see it? Yeah, sneaking in there. So welcome if you're watching online and staying shielding. That's fantastic. Obviously, normally we'd have sofas and it would smell of coffee and everything. That day will come, my friends. But not just yet. But we're patient. Can we give a warm welcome to Reverend Emma Dornan? Now, knowing her, she would be the first person to say that each of us has a calling, each of us has a vocation, each of us is just as valuable in the kingdom as a child and a daughter. She's nodding. So we're not kind of elevating, but we are recognizing that what happened yesterday is a significant event for you and for us as a church. And we just want to celebrate with you and pray for you as we have been. We've got a little card that says Rev Emma. I'm sure it's probably not the first card. Do you just want to stand up and stand in the middle? Where's your beloved? There he is. Michael, do you just come and join us? We've prayed for you before, but hey, we'll pray for you again. And you can't be projecting prayers, but stretch out a hand if you feel comfortable. And let's pray for these lovely guys. Father, thank you for Emma. Thank you for Michael. Thank you for the particular gifts and qualities of character that they have. And as we'll be hearing, you've brought them to this place. And we ask your rich blessing upon them as they move out from the old and settle in this new land. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you guys. Great. Thank you for helping us with the COVID restrictions and things that they are in place so that we can care and love one another and care for each other. So really do appreciate it. Let's be still for a second. I'm going to read you from Colossians chapter 3. Since then you have been raised to new life with Christ. Set your sights on the realities of heaven, where Christ sits in the place of honor at God's right hand. Think about the things of heaven, not the things of earth. For you died to this life, and your real life is hidden with Christ in God. And when Christ, who is your life, is revealed to the whole world, you will share in his glory. So, Father, as we set our sights on things that are more than just the here and the now, and we set our sights on you, on the things of heaven and of the kingdom of God, the things that will not pass away, we invite you, Holy Spirit, to come and lead every part of our service, of our worship together, to reach out to those who are here, those who are watching online, that each of us may be drawn to you, encouraged, forgiven, set apart, and sent out. Just for a moment, kind of reflect, where do you find yourself today? I'm going to use two images. If you were swimming, do you feel like you're treading water? Do you feel like you're sinking? Or do you feel like you're doing the front crawl to the horizon because you got it, you're on it? Or for the non-sporty amongst us, if you're a traffic sign this morning, would you be a one-way sign, a dead end, a danger sign, feeling like you're in danger, on a roundabout that you can't get off, restricted by a speed limit, or roadworks, or diverted? Lord, we want to be honest and real with you, because you know our thoughts of our hearts and the motives anyway, about where we find ourselves today in our walk with you, in life in general. And so we say, God, here we are. Lead us forward, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, why don't we stand? And although we can't sing, you can just move about, you can enjoy as the band lead us in King of Love and Grace. And then you can go and sing it at home, but stand up and enjoy it, dance around. If you want to, you can move into the aisles, you can stay sat if you want. You're free to worship as you feel comfortable.
Goodness and mercy will always follow. kingdom come, your will be done. All your promises will stand forever. You're my defender. You go before me. You're there beside me. And if I wander, love will find me. Goodness and mercy will always follow. You go before me, my guardian. You are God, our great defender, strong in love, forever faithful. We are yours and we will trust in you.
As we stand, this morning we're going to be thinking about the life of Abraham. I don't know how much you know about him. He's one of the key figures in the Old Testament and, is quoted throughout. Really, really important. But as we think about heroes and anti-heroes in the Old Testament, which Emma's going to be preaching on him in just a moment, Abraham was called to the promised land. And he set out, which we're going to be thinking about. He moved to Egypt, and there he acquired wealth and did really well. He split from his cousin Lot because there was too many of them and they were struggling to fit in the same area. He rescued Lot from local rulers. He was part of a covenant, of an agreement with God that said, God was saying, I will be faithful to you and you will expand and you'll be the father of many nations. God told him that he must circumcise every male to set them apart, to be different as the people of God. Abraham was involved in pleading for the town of Sodom. And he was promised children beyond his wildest dreams, and yet even beyond the age of childbearing. And then, towards the end, Abraham, chapter 22, just 22 chapters into the Bible, is told to take his son out into a distant part, into the wilderness. And he put wood on his son's shoulders that the son didn't know at the time, but it was to be the wood that he would die on. And then out in the wilderness, his son Isaac said, Father, where is the lamb going to come from? And Abraham says, the Lord himself will provide a lamb for the sacrifice. And just at the moment where, in obedience, the son was going to give his own, the father was going to give his only son, God provided a lamb. And there in the thicket was a ram caught by its horns that Abraham was able to sacrifice. 22 chapters into the Bible, we see a model of Jesus. We see the father willing to give his own son. 22 chapters into scripture, you see a son carrying the wood on which he was about to die. 22 chapters into the scriptures, we see a picture of Jesus. Father, we thank you that the symphony and the melody of all scripture, from page one to the final page, is of your incredible, almost reckless, extravagant love. And Father, I pray that every person here, every person watching online, will know that that is the scent, the fragrance, the constant through scripture. We say that we long to know you better. And so we pray that as Emma comes to speak now, that you will anoint her to speak, that you'll anoint her to teach, and you'll anoint our hearts to listen to you in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, as Emma gets ready, just let me just say one quick thing while I think of it. You know, we long to have more noise of kids at the back. So I just want to say a huge welcome to the children that are here. Obviously, at the moment, things are difficult. I'm meeting with the children's team over the next week or two as we plan how we can do children's work and the extent to which we can do it. But I just want to say, for those of you watching online and the kids at the back, you're really, really welcome. And we're looking forward to when we're able to do that. But never mind, we never mind kids making noise and being kids. Look forward to more of it. Just getting microphones sorted. Are you okay? Thank you, team. Perfect.
Sorry about that. It is very exciting to be preaching to you today. And to a dog. I love dogs, so that's not more exciting than preaching to you. Definitely not, but also exciting. Hello, everyone online, including my mum. So I'm going to begin today by telling you a little bit of the story that brought us here to Torquay to be with you, because it's relevant to the story of Abraham, who I'm preaching about today. So when you are approved to train in the Church of England, what that means usually is that you are uprooted from the community that you're in already, your church, maybe your family, somewhere you've been for a long time. You're taken from a place where people know you and you might be quite comfortable. And if you train residentially, you're then lifted from there and planted into a theological college, into another community somewhere else. And it is an amazing experience, and it is a privilege, but it is also a very complicated one. It is a mixed blessing. It is one in which your assumptions are challenged. The things you think you know about God and the things you think you know about yourself. A few years ago, I had a revelation from God, and he showed me that I had thought when he shapes you, when he molds you like clay, it sort of tickles, it feels nice. And actually, what I realized, what he showed me, is that when you shape clay on a wheel, it's spinning, and it has his pressure, the pressure of his hands applied to you. And it's a little bit like that when you submit to God's will for your life, as I'm sure you know, and when you submit to training to be a priest. It's kind of that, but ramped up a bit. The spinning, the head spinning and the pressure. Lewis is nodding, so you know it's not just my experience. It's intense. And yet you stay in that place for a while, and then you're called to move again. And as we'll hear, in Abraham's story, God says to him, go to a place that I will show you. And that's a really poignant word for people in training and in all stages of life. But when you're training to be a vicar, there comes a point where you've finished your academic stuff and God says, and the church says, go to a place that I will show you. And so you go out into the unknown land of the Church of England and you travel, not for years, mercifully, but you travel and you visit different churches and you work out with them and discern with God, is this where you're calling my family? And so we did that, Michael and I did that, and we went to the first church that they sent us to, and we left and I wept because I could not see us flourishing there. I could not see us living there. We sat in the car afterwards and I just said to him, how are we going to live with what they're asking me to do? How are we going to live? And we said, no, And it was a really hard no. And then we went to another one. And it was a no there too. And another one. And every time we're praying, Lord, may it be this one. And that was a no as well. And then we came to one that was so wonderful. I wept with joy at the thought of being there. And there were people in it that we knew really, really well. And they said, no, we don't feel it's where you're called to be. And we wept, and it was hard. And we said, where are you, God? And we stopped. And then we went on to another one. 5 or 6 by this point. And I'm saying, God, this doesn't make me look good, mate. They're going to think I'm really fussy. No one's going to want me. It's like Pretty Woman. Not Pretty Woman, the other one. Doesn't matter. Doesn't look good at me, Lord. I'm going to look really fussy. This is not good. Do you realize what you're doing here, mate? This is my image. I've not got a lot. And still, it wasn't that one. And we wanted it to be, but it wasn't. And then I got an email saying there are curacies just being released in Exeter. They're just coming together. They're a bit embryonic. And we read the description of this church. And we read your vision statement, and we looked at your website. And Michael and I, we recognized you. And I've said this to Sam, and I promise you, I wouldn't say it if it wasn't true. We recognized the heart God had put in us, in the heart that he's put in you, in the vision and the values that you're already living, and in who you are wanting to be. And we recognized you as the people God was calling us to. And we made inquiries, and here we are. And those of you that cleaned our house know that it's been a bumpy journey. But here we are. And I can honestly say that the longer we're here, the more perfect it feels. And so, it's all good. Thank you. And so on that note, let us turn to the life of Abraham. This, as Sam has said, is the second sermon in our series, our new series, Heroes, Anti-Heroes, and Villains of the Old Testament. Now, I'll be honest with you. Before preparing this sermon, I didn't actually know what an anti-hero was. So, in case any of you are in the same position, I thought I would give a quick definition. An anti-hero is a central character in a story, film, or drama who lacks conventional, heroic attributes. This is handy because today we are learning about Abraham, who was known as the father of nations, yet who twice endangered his wife by passing her off as his sister to save his own skin. Abraham was one of the original patriarchs, which means father of the faith. But he was also an anti-hero. Nonetheless, there is a lot that we can learn about how to follow the Lord from Abraham's life. Abraham's story can be found in the book of Genesis, beginning at chapter 11, several chapters after the accounts of Adam and Eve and the flood narrative. For the first half of Abraham's life, he went by a different name. And it is by this name, Abram. If I can have my slide up, please. That's all right. It's no hurry. Sorry, that's me. Anyway, it's by this name, Abram, that we are first introduced to him in Genesis 11, 26. Abram lived at a time where many gods were worshipped, yet through his forefather Noah, he inherited faith in and a relationship with Yahweh, the one true God. The passage that this sermon is based on, Genesis 12, verse 31 to 11:31 to 12, verse 9, is something I wanted to talk about. It's often called Abraham's Call. And in it, we hear God and Abraham talking. In chapter 12, verse 1, God says to Abraham, "Go from your country and your kindred and your father's house to the land that I will show you." This is odd, because earlier in chapter 11, verse 31, we read that Abraham and his family had already left their homeland, destined for Canaan, but had stopped en route, instead settling in a place called Haran. In other words, Abraham's call is not the uprooting we sometimes imagine it to be, but it is instead a shaking and a call to leave the middle place. Now, here's the cool thing. Haran, the place that he stayed in, means parched. So the picture we begin to see developing here is not one of God tearing Abraham's family from the nourishing soil that had been home. It is instead God lifting them from a barren place. I'll clear the carpet, sorry. Where they hadn't been flourishing as much as they could, and God repotting them somewhere where they have more space to grow. Church, I believe this is a word for us, but also for particular individuals here. And so I pray, Holy Spirit, that if that is right, you would confirm this message in the hearts of those who hear it. And that includes people online, not just here in person. And so, we find God calling Abraham to an as yet undisclosed location. In chapter 12, verse 4, we read, "So Abraham went out as the Lord told him." Initially, Abraham and his family set out for Canaan, which is the place they were aiming for when they ended up in Haran. However, chapter 12, verse 5 to 7 tells us, "When they came to the land of Canaan, Abraham passed through it. Then the Lord appeared to Abraham." In other words, God met Abraham just past the end of his plans. Can anyone else relate to that? Here at St. Mag's, two of our values are learning and recovery. Now, I know that I'm new here, but I already understand that these values are not destinations, but journeys. They are not only core to who we are now, but they are statements about who we want to be moving forward. Abraham's whole life was a journey, traveling from one place to another. And we see in it patterns or cycles, a bit like you do in recovery. He had highs and he had lows. He had successes and he had failures. He had cycles he broke out of and positive ones that he took on. And if you read his story, you'll see that often he would go somewhere and God would speak to him and then he would build an altar and he would worship God there. Throughout Abraham's story, we see that he kept moving, leaving behind things that God called him to leave behind and moving on to the new blessings and places that God had for him. Similarly, Abraham's journey was one of learning, of hearing the voice of God better, and of learning to listen to the voice of his faith rather than the voice of his fear. Abraham's journey was also one of action. In Genesis 13, God promises Abraham that his descendants will possess the land. God then says to him, "Arise, walk through the length and breadth of the land, for I will give it to you." Arise, walk through the length and breadth of the land, for I will give it to you. If you could relate to what I said earlier about Haran, about the parched place, about the middle land, then take note of this. As God led Abraham on, he did so, commanding him to arise and to walk the boundaries of the land he would inhabit, in order to claim it as his own. He was required to take possession of the inheritance God was wanting to give him. And I wonder how many of us God is calling to do that today. As we continue to navigate the life of Abraham, we see a man with huge flaws and huge faith. At the end of chapter 12, you can read an account of Abraham abandoning his wife Sarai to the Egyptian Pharaoh, who then temporarily takes her as his wife. The issue with this, one of the issues with this, is that she may then have been made to have sex with him as his wife rather than Abraham's. And that means that she was abandoned by her husband. That was pretty anti-heroic on Abraham's part, to say the least. In chapter 14, we read the account of Abraham rescuing his nephew Lot from Sodom and Gomorrah, and of him being blessed by Melchizedek the priest, who was a forerunner to Jesus. If you want a head-spinning Bible study, have a look at all the references to Melchizedek in the Bible. I can tell you how to spell it if you need. It's very complicated. In chapter 16, we see Abraham consenting to sleep with Hagar, Sarai's mistress, maid, to produce an heir. And yet elsewhere, Abraham is the first person in Scripture to establish a tithe of 10% of his wealth, which he is praised for. Then, in chapter 17, after this really mixed picture of a man has developed, we read, When Abraham was 99 years old, the Lord appeared to him and said, "I am God Almighty. Walk before me and be blameless, so that I may make a covenant between me and you, and you shall be the father of a multitude of nations. No longer shall you be Abram, but you shall be Abraham, for I have made you the father of a multitude of nations." By this point, Abram was over halfway through his life. He'd made some pretty terrible mistakes. He'd rescued people. He'd been rewarded with blessing and righteousness. And at this point, he wasn't actually the father of any nations. Yet, God speaks to him as the person he is to become, not as the person he currently is. For all of us on journeys, whether we are in a parched land or a flourishing one at the moment, God calls us deeper, and he doesn't just see who we are now, but who he is calling us to be. For Abraham, this meant a subtle change in his name that redefined his destiny, his vision, and his legacy. Only God knows what this could mean for each of us and for us as a community. And so, in summary, Abraham was one of the original patriarchs of our faith. He was an anti-hero, but he was also, at times, a hero. His story demonstrates that following God's call is a journey on which he forgives us when we fall, he rewards our wise decisions, and he redefines our identity, giving us a new purpose and name.
Thank you, Emma. Thank you so much. That was fantastic. Would you like to, actually, before you stand, let's pray. Because I'm going to ask you to stand. We can't come forward for prayer ministry at the moment, but the invitation to arise is to stand, is to, from where you find yourself right here today, is to stand up and to set out. So, Father, as we began, will you show us where we find ourselves? If we find that we're stuck in a place that is parched and dry, if we find ourselves stuck in a place that is only that is just partway to where you've called us to, then stand. If we find ourselves wanting to move out from this place, to move on to all that God has called us to do and the person he's called us to be, then stand. And if you just want to say, God, I'm not quite sure where I'm at, but I know I want to do it with you, then stand. Jesus, there is hero and anti-hero in each of us. But you call us onwards. So just for these next couple of songs, use this as a time to do business with God, to talk to him about where you're at, what life's about, what your priorities are. Do business with him. Set out with him afresh today. And then after that, we're going to do something as a church, I think. So the band are going to lead us in a couple of songs and just use this as an opportunity to worship, to pray, to move forwards with God.
Commit again all I am for you, Lord. You hold my world in the palm of your hands, and I am yours forever. Jesus, I believe. Jesus, I belong. Jesus, I believe. Spirit, Lord, is guiding me to do your will. He brings me strength in times of need and comforts me.
Can you put the mic on, the handheld mic?
Hello? Yep, you can hear me. Hi, everyone. I'm 2 foot shorter than I normally am. I'm Simon, if nobody knows me, and I just want to share really quickly. It come to me when Emma was just preaching about Abraham, and I know a lot about Abraham as a child, because some of you know that my uncle was a vicar as well, so I heard a lot as a Christian growing up. Over the last 5 weeks, my physical life has deteriorated with my back injury. And then 2 weeks ago, I had an injury in the house where I was stuck, and there was paramedics, and there was morphine, and there was screaming and crying, and I was taken into hospital. And then it was like, well, we just don't know what we're going to do right now. So they sent me home with a carrier bag of painkillers, and I've been at home since, and I've been wondering what I could do, and this, that, and the other. But I've still been coming to the living rooms, and I've still been doing morning and evening prayers. More than I ever have, it's feeling stronger and stronger. And Trina gave me these wonderful 3 books that I started reading. And it's Battlefield of the Mind, and it's got amazing derivatives from the Bible. And what I've learned over the last week, since Emma asked me if she could lay a hand on me last week and pray for me, something's changed in me. And it's my faith. And the last 2 days, I've never cried so much as I have in the last 10 years. I don't know what's happened to me. But my faith has just got stronger and stronger and stronger this week. And I have got worse and worse and had to end up in a wheelchair. And I think it's because God wants me to stop. He wants me to stop, look around, and realize what I'm here to do and to help people. And that's the time for me to grow is now. He's showing me how I can grow. So I've come to a standstill. And with my faith, I believe that this is temporary and that very soon I will be back out of this wheelchair and up and walking around again, doing the things that God wants me to do. So thanks for listening to me. Cheers.
Father, I thank you for what you're doing in Simon. Thank you that that is actually a real picture, something prophetic about that. That actually when we're stopped, as we have been in these last months, you grow us and you draw us into a place that is flourishing, that is growing, as you are with Simon. And so as we sing this next song, When the Music Fades, Lord, thank you for the faith of Simon's testimony and the faith in him. We ask you to do the same in us. When the music fades and all else is stripped away, we simply come longing just to bring an offering to you, Lord.
Away, and I simply come, longing just to bring something that's worth, that will bless your heart. I'll bring you more than a song, for a song in itself is not what you have required. Much deeper within, through the way things appear, you're looking into my heart. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I've made it, when it's all
is quiet, but there's just a lovely sense of God's presence. More of you, Lord Jesus, more of you. By your Spirit, come. Rachel just brought me this passage from 1 Peter chapter 2, and it says this: "But you are God's chosen treasure, priests who are kings, a spiritual nation set apart for God's devoted ones, as God's devoted ones. He called you out of darkness to experience his marvelous light, and now he claims you as his very own. He did this so that you would broadcast his glorious wonders through the world." Do you agree with that? Do you agree with that? He did this so that he's called you out of darkness to experience his marvelous light, and now he claims you as his own. He did this so that you would broadcast his wonders throughout the world. Well, as we come towards the end of our service, slightly differently, I'm going to ask you, if you're able to, again, to stand. And I don't know how this is going to go, but just stand with me. And I'm going to play a piece of music. Let me just check this. You know, we've responded individually about standing up and setting out with God. But this piece of music is encouraging us to pray for our bay, to pray for our nation, to pray for Torquay. And to broadcast his glorious wonders throughout the world. So I just want you to use this song to pray for our town, to pray for the streets and the communities that you live, to pray for the schools and the places of the people in authority, to pray for the guys on the streets out at Castle Circus right now, to just allow God to inspire your prayers, your intercession as you pray for our nation. And once we've heard the words, because the words repeat, I'm also going to put a piece of footage on that just shows you the bay to help you to pray, okay? So we'll just go for that. Obviously, you're praying quietly at the moment, but just you can go out, you can go to the walls if you want, you can stretch your hand out if you want, or you can just kneel if you want. Let's pray for our town. Let's pray, almost as Emma was saying, you know, us walking the boundaries, so to speak, to pray the boundaries and to see in our mind's eye the town that we live, and pray that it will, that God's kingdom within it will be expanded. Does that make sense? So let's do it. I'll play the song and then we'll show you some footage whilst the words continue.
Here I cry, O King of Heaven, Jesus, hope to every heart. We are lost without your glory. We are lost without you, God. Be the fire that burns within us, flames of love that purify. Send your power and your salvation. Let us see your kingdom come. 'Cause only you can move the mountains. Only you can heal our land. Christ alone. Father's love, lead us home and out of darkness with your gospel burning bright. 'Cause only you can move the mountains, only you can heal our land. Christ alone, I hope and glory, Christ alone. Can move the mountain.
Jesus, we pray for our beautiful bay. We pray for all those places, Paignton, Brixham, Preston, Torquay, we'll watch it again, our High Street, Lord, St. Luke's Church there. Pray for Livermead Bay. We pray for the other churches in our town, for the URC and the Methodist. We pray for the parklands. We pray for the accommodation. We pray for the businesses. We pray for the coach park and the council. Lord, we pray for the empty shops. We pray for those at sea. We pray for those on boats. And we pray that as people look to the top of the church, that actually they'll start to look to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, friends, we've come to the end of our time together. You are going to probably want to stand up in a second. Can I just thank you to our fantastic worship team for leading us this morning. It's lovely that we have able to have more than one voice. That's been really, really, really good. And although it was lovely with just one voice, I hasten to add. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for gathering us together in person and online. From Colossians chapter 3 again. Let the message about Christ in all its richness fill your lives. Teach and counsel each other with the wisdom that he gives. Sing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs to God with thankful hearts. That's what we've been doing. And whatever you do or say, do it as a representative of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks through him to God the Father. And may the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit rest upon each of you. Amen. Well, before we have a final piece of music, Trina, I forgot to ask, how have guys been online? Yeah, go for that. And I'm just going to show, because people often ask, you know, how many, are we going to, let's just do this. For the sake of those who are online, you can wave, say hi, everyone. There we go.
Hello.
Hello. There we go. Trina.
Yeah, so we've had 26 Zoom. People on online. Loads of welcomes, Emma. Amazing. Claps. Love for you. So that's lovely. Pauline's 150 miles away, and she was so pleased to be able to connect still with her family. Lots of amens to you, Si, if you're out there. People are praying for you. Tears of healing, Simon. Pauline was told in 1995 she would never walk again, but look at her now. And that woman can run now. Bless her. So lots of people still feel like they're connecting to Mags's family. Jude put, I'm so, so grateful to have access to your wonderful community online. Thank you.
Great.
And Nick and Ali Ford said the spirit is with them at home, so what more can you ask for?
There we go. Yeah. Fantastic. Well, thank you. Thanks, Trina, for doing that important role this morning. Okay. We're going to go, and if you need to, you can go now. But just to end, we thought we'd have a little, we'll listen to Wren Collective. This is our Resurrection Day. God is in the business of giving life. That's the distinctiveness of being a Christian. So jump up, enjoy it, worship, thank God for the life that he's given you and the life that he's promised. Let's worship together. And then God bless you, folks. Enjoy your week and see you online and see you next Sunday.
Is powerful because you rose invincible. I can get up off.